Hi guys, so today I'm going to be doing a video which is really different from what I'm used to doing, and it is going to be the science behind the low carb diet. Now, if you have been struggling with your weight and you've been trying to like exercise and diet and just lose weight in general, I'm sure you have heard about this low carb diet, which is mainly like taking out carbs in your diet and, you know, adding up the vegetables and the lean proteins and everything like that. Have you ever wondered exactly why the low-carb diet works? Yeah, so this is what I'm going to teach you guys in this video, exactly why the low-carb diet works in our bodies. And this is going to be completely science, but it's so cool because then you guys are going to actually be like, I promise at least one of you at the end of the video is going to be like, oh, like it makes sense. It makes sense why this low carb diet works. I mean, I'll be going to detail exactly how it works, of course. But for right now, I'm just gonna prepare you for awesomeness. I know you guys, I bet half of you that are watching this video don't really care about science. But if you do, like me, you might appreciate this video just a little bit because it's incorporating science into your everyday life, which is like what I love because I don't know, it gives you more of a connection to science and what you're learning in your classes. And from personal experience, I have been one of those people who have been struggling with my weight and stuff. And I did go on a low-carb diet, and I lost like 20 pounds, so not even kidding, actually. So I really do stand by this diet. I will leave links below for more in-depth of what each of the processes I do talk about, because I really do the nitty-gritty. I just want to show you guys how carbs go through your body and make energy compared to when you limit your amount of carbs and how your fat storage is utilized instead. I hope you guys are excited as I am. So let's get on to my video. So the most typical types of carbohydrates include breads, pastas, everything that I kind of really like to eat. Pizza, sweets especially. Even though people don't think sugary things are sweets, anything with flour and sugar are carbohydrates. Now, carbohydrates consist of monosaccharides, and the most common monosaccharide out there is glucose, which is a 6-carbon ringed molecule, as you can see that I'm drawing right here below. So the first process I want to talk about is glycolysis, and glycolysis takes the glucose that we eat from our breads and our carbs and everything, and it converts it into 2 pyruvates, 2 ATPs, and 2 NADHs. We will be talking about the 2 pyruvates in the next step, but for now, the 2 ATPs and 2 NADHs we'll be saving for later. So those 2 pyruvates are put into pyruvate dehydrogenase, which is an enzyme. Anything ending with an ase at the end is most likely an enzyme when talking about biochemistry. So those 2 pyruvates are converted into acetyl-CoA, and then we put acetyl-CoA into the Krebs cycle, which is going to be the third step in this long process. So the next step is the Krebs cycle, also known as the citric acid cycle. And I actually really like learning about this, which is kind of why I decided to draw it out. Because it's a nice circle, everything's being recycled with every acetyl-CoA going inside. So what happens is that C4 molecule that you see at the very end of the cycle next to acetyl-CoA on the left, that C4 molecule combines with acetyl-CoA, which is a 2-carbon molecule, and then in the end it makes the C6-carbon molecule, if that was just a little bit confusing. And this cycle just produces all these different things, especially ATP and these electron carriers, which is the NADH and FADH. As I mentioned before, the glycolysis made the NADH. Next and final step of this carbohydrate synthesis into energy is the electron transport chain. And again, I really find this fun, so hence why I decided to draw it. We have these complexes that are embedded inside the plasma membrane of the mitochondria, which I'm indicating those complexes with these Roman numerals. And the plasma membrane is indicated by these circles and squiggly lines on the left side, which are phospholipids. And what these complexes do is they take those electron carriers, which I hope you remember before, the NADH and the FADH2, and when they are converted into NAD+ and fumarate, they release H+s, which are protons, and electrons. So these protons are carried across this membrane through the complexes, which causes a surplus of hydrogen on the left side. or on the upper side of the plasma membrane, and the flow of electrons go through these complexes, which end up at the last complex, 4. These electrons are then added to oxygen in order to make water. So with all the H pluses going on the outside of the plasma membrane, it causes a high concentration of protons, and it wants to go back inside to the plasma membrane, which it goes through this ATP synthase, which has an FO and F1 subunit. So the H pluses go through the FO, and this causes the F1 subunit to start rotating. This rotating motion causes an ATP to be formed, which was made earlier by an ADP plus a pi. Now, what is ATP? We saw ATP earlier in a couple other processes like glycolysis and the Krebs cycles. So ATP is energy. ATP is exactly what is making us move when we talk, any kind of body movement that we're making, it's ATP. So now that we've finished learning how carbs are turned into ATP, now we're going to be talking about what happens when we don't have that many carbs. How exactly do we make ATP? Well, it's great because we use our fats. In general, we should limit the amount of fats we do eat, but if we do limit the amount of fats as well as carbs, your body will start to use your body fat. Fats are also made out of fatty acids, which I kind of blew over a little bit, but we'll get back to it later. So in order for fatty acids to go inside the mitochondria, they actually need to be attached to carnitine in order to go inside, because fatty acids, something about the plasma membrane, it just won't let it go inside the mitochondria, in short. So the carnitine transporter transports it inside the mitochondria, and then the carnitine comes off it, so it's just fatty acid. So now we're going to be talking about beta oxidation. So once inside the mitochondria, through a series of steps, this fatty acid chain is broken down 2 carbons at a time. And I've indicated that by showing you this is what a typical fatty acid molecule looks like, and 2 carbons are taken off every time. And those 2 carbons are made into acetyl-CoA. Now, if you guys remember from the earlier sections of this video, acetyl-CoA goes through the Krebs cycle in order to make a little bit of ATP and electron carriers, and then those electron carriers are put into electron transport chain and make a lot more ATP. So that's the really simplified version of how your body uses carbs versus fats in order to make ATP. And when you don't have that many carbs, your body goes to your body fat storage in order to make ATP. So that's it, you guys. I hope your minds have just been blown. I hope you learned something from this. I don't know. That's what I want from this channel. I want you guys to learn stuff. For those of you who are, you know, thinking of losing weight and trying to figure out what I should be eating and what I shouldn't, the low carb, man, it does work. It does. And here's the science to back up. Here's the, proof that'll show you that it'll work. I'll talk to you guys later. Bye.